Hey guys, a very good morning to all of you. So myself, Sneha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs for phase one of banking examinations like RBI, SEBI, NABARD or any kind of other bank exam at the level of PU. So this is the series for December 3rd, 2020 and let's begin the series without wasting any time. But the people who are coming for the first time, they can subscribe this channel and hit this bell notification. Also, you guys can join this Telegram group where we share free quizzes as well as resolve your queries. Now, here is the first question, which is about the first memorial for organ donation. So, where is the India's first memorial for organ donation established? Organ donors. So, this has been recently established, or we can say that the full construction work, the construction work is going to be completed of this memorial. So it is still in its construction stage, but yeah, still we need to know this, where is it going to be built. So it is going to be located in Rajasthan, in the city of Jaipur. Now guys, do you know that India also observes National Organ Donation Day? Now when is it observed? This is your task to find out. Even if you are not answering the questions in the comment box, even then, you should make it a point to find out the answers of the questions that I ask in the video, because they are the background questions, static information that you should be aware of if you are going for any kind of examination, competitive examination. So do find it out that when does India observe National Organ Donation Day? Who heads the Apex Committee for the implementation of the Paris Agreement? So central government has formed this committee recently, and this committee is going to provide the guidelines and monitor the progress made towards the implementation of Paris Agreement. Now guys, do you know when was this Paris Agreement signed? So that is your task to tell me in the comment section below. Now for this question, let's discuss the details. So this is the 17 member committee, and it is going to be chaired by the Secretary of Ministry of Environment. So remember this thing, that the rank of the chairperson of this committee is always be the Secretary of Ministry of Environment as per the official notification. And now who is that person, who is the present Secretary of Ministry of Environment? So the person is Rameshwar Prasad Gupta. He is the incumbent Secretary of Ministry of Environment, and at the present time he is the chairperson of this Apex Committee that has been formulated for the implementation of Paris Agreement. And when was this agreement signed? That is your task to tell me in the comment section below. Now guys, do you know that this Paris Agreement is implemented by each and every country, member country, through their own nationally determined contributions? So each and every country has set their own targets to achieve this Paris Agreement. So what are India's targets? Let's discuss those targets in the next slide. So here are the India's nationally determined contributions to Paris Agreement. So these are the three quantitative targets that have been given by India. Apart from this quantitative targets, there are other non-quantitative targets as well that have been provided by India, but they are not of that much importance, that we will not be discussing that here. So from the phase one point of view, these facts are very important for you to remember. Now let's discuss the contributions or the targets that India has set. A 33 to 35% reduction in the GDP emissions intensity by 2030 from 2005 levels. So what is the meaning of this hectic sentence? Let's break it into the simple meaning. The simple meaning of this sentence is that by the year 2030, India is going to reduce its carbon emissions by 33 to 35% from the level of 2005. So guys, this is not a very new target that you must be hearing. This is a very common target that you must have heard about earlier as well. The second target of India is a 40% share of non-fossil fuel based electricity by 2030. So that is why India is pushing renewable energy to that extent. This is because of this 40% share totally of total electricity generation should be from renewable sector. Now this reminds me that I need to know from you guys that what is the renewable energy target of India by the year 2022. So there is a catch here. So let me see guys in the comment section that can you catch that thing? What is the treasure here? So what is the target of India in the terms of renewable energy? That you have to tell me in the comment section below. Third point here is creating a carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide through afforestation programs. Now, what is the meaning of this third point? This third point means to say that India is going to push afforestation drive, and through this afforestation, India is going to have the carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons. Now, what is the meaning of carbon sink? Carbon sink refers to the equipments or to the technology which is used to absorb carbon, and that carbon is utilized for other purposes. Okay, so through the afforestation drive, India is going to create carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons. So these are the three targets, and in order to achieve these three targets, this committee has been formed. So remember all the points that I have told you here, and do not forget to mention the answers of the questions in the comment section below. Which has become the first country in Central America to apply for the WHO malaria free certification? Remember guys that this question has come up from the World Malaria Report 2020. So we will be discussing the details of World Malaria Report later on, but first let's discuss that which country it is that has applied for this malaria free certification. So this is El Salvador. So it is a Central American country, and the first Central American country that has become malaria free. Remember this thing. Now if we are discussing El Salvador, so you must be aware about the static facts related to this. So capital and currency, remember the capital and currency of El Salvador. Now let's discuss the World Malaria Report 2020. So guys, here you can see that I have mentioned all the facts related to World Malaria Report 2020. COVID-19 and funding shortages are posing risk to the future gains in malaria prevention. So this is a very obvious fact. We all know that COVID-19 and the funding shortages that have arisen due to the COVID-19 are posing a great risk towards achieving the health goals in various diseases. So it's not only malaria, there are other diseases like pneumonia as well, where India is lacking due to the funding shortages and due to the COVID-19 pandemic. What is the next fact? 2019 global malarial cases are 229 million. And this number has not been changed for over the last 4 years. So this indicates the reduction in progress that the world is making towards eliminating malaria. Guys, remember this thing that this is the number in 2019 before the COVID era. Therefore, it highlights the reduction in progress, the redundancy in progress towards achieving the elimination of malaria, which has been increased, or we can say which has been boosted by COVID-19. So earlier also the world was lagging, and now the lag is going to expand. Now, so this is the total number of cases. Remember this thing. A question can be made on this number as well. 2019 global malarial deaths, 4.9 lakh as compared to 4.11 lakh in 2018. So there was a marginal decrease in the number of deaths due to malaria. Guys, here you need to know this thing that malaria is a completely preventable disease, and we have the technology to prevent malaria. And even after having those technologies, people are dying due to malaria. So it's a shame for the world that the world is not able to achieve the targets of eliminating malaria or diseases like these. The third point here is African region accounts for the highest burden of malaria globally. So we know this thing. This is a very basic generic fact. Another, among other high burden to high impact countries. What is this high burden to high impact countries? Guys, this is a grouping which was made by WHO in 2018. So the countries, there are total 11 countries in this group, and the 11 countries account for almost 70% of the total cases of malaria in the world. So this is such a high number, 70% of total malarial cases are from the high impact, high burden countries, high burden, high impact countries. And there are a total number of 11 countries which are there in this grouping, including India. So here, this is significant that India is also a part of this group, which accounts for 70% of global malarial cases. Now, what does this report say about this thing, about this grouping? This report says that among these countries, India has shown impressive gains with reduction in cases and deaths of 18%. So, 18% cases have reduced, and by 20% malarial deaths have reduced over the last 2 years. So, this is a very significant, impressive gain that India has achieved among the high burden to high impact countries. Now, what is the actual number of malarial cases in India? About 5.6 million in 2019, even though we had 20 million in 2000. So, this is a very significant reduction if we see the span of 19 years from 2000 to 2019. So, 5.6 million people were there who were infected by malaria in 2019, and a total number of 7,700 people died due to malaria. And this fact we have discussed already. So, El Salvador became the first country in Central America to apply for WHO malarial-free certification. So, we have discussed everything about World Malaria Report. Now, guys, your task is to remember the points, static points related to WHO. That who is the Director General, when was WHO established, how many countries are member of WHO, and what is the headquarter, where is the headquarter of WHO. So these are some of the static facts related to WHO that you should keep in mind. So the next question is from OECD. What is the GDP growth rate for India for FY21 by OECD? So OECD has upgraded its contraction rate or its GDP forecast for India, and now it has projected -9.9% GDP growth rate for India for FY21. For FY22, the rate is 7.9%. And 4.8% growth rate is for FY23. So these are the 3 years forecasts that has been given by OECD. Apart from these facts, OECD has also mentioned this thing that China is going to be the fastest growing country in 2021. So this is a very conspicuous fact that since in 2020 as well, China is the highest growing country, is the fastest growing country in the world. And in 2021, it is going to repeat the same trend. So that's all for this question. Now we are moving towards our next question. Which country has the highest average monthly mobile data traffic per smartphone according to the Ericsson Mobile Report 2020? So guys, as we know that internet affordability is very good in India, and so the country that has highest average monthly mobile data traffic per smartphone is India. Which organization has released this report? It is Ericsson itself. Now, where is it located? So this is your homework to find it out, that where is Ericsson located. Now guys, apart from this, there were nothing major facts in this news. Apart from this, there was one major fact that by the year 2023, 3G net will be phased out, and we will only have the 5G internet connections. So that was a very basic fact But this fact is important that India has the highest average monthly mobile data per data traffic per smartphone. So remember this fact. In which journal is the lifetime risk of diabetes in metropolitan cities in India report launched? Not launched, published. So in which journal was it published? It was published in Diabetologia. So very easy to guess this thing. And remember as well that Diabetologia is the journal in which this lifetime risk of diabetes in metropolitan cities in India report was published. Now, this report mentions that at present there are 77 million people in India that are diagnosed or suffering from diabetes. And this number is going to double by the year 2045. So by the year 2045, there will be 134 million people who will be suffering from diabetes. So this is a very huge fact. This is a very drastic, we can say, very important fact that you should remember. Apart from this, this report also states that the people who are in their 20s have a higher life risk of diabetes. So here you have to remember this thing as well. So that's all for this question, and I hope that you have understood what I have taught you in this video. So guys, the questions that I have asked you in this video, I expect that you will answer those questions in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching this video. Good luck for your exams.